I'm privileged to have as my guest today one of the great American composers, his name, George Perle. I could talk at length about your accomplishments, your books, and so forth, but what I want to know first, George, is, and I've been waiting for it for a while, is where is your book on the Berg's opera Lulu?
Fortunately, it's at last at the publisher after 20 years.
20 years in the creation of a book.
Something like that. Well, two books, of course, the Butzek and Lulu. And I've done some things in the interim. During that period, I wrote another book called 12-Tone Tonality, which is my second book.
Well, that's a revolutionary book in pedagogy, I would say.
Yes, not in pedagogy necessarily, but in the theory of music.
Yes, the theory of music.
My first book is rather more a pedagogical book, I guess, the serial composition of Atonality, which came out in 1961. So I have been doing some other things during these 20 years, and I've composed a lot of music. But I've also been working on those two operas, and it started with Lulu. First, I didn't know I was going to write a book, actually.
Well, it's a handsome book, by the way. Volume 1, which is Wozzeck, The Operas of Alban Berg by George Perle, who's my guest today, is published by the California...
The University of California Press.
Well, this is a gorgeous-looking book, and...
They do a very handsome job.
So you're going to have your Lulu out as Volume 2 of this soon.
Well, I would say in a year, maybe. You know, it takes a little while.
George, you have changed in 20 years. What about the enthusiasm that started with Lulu? Did it sustain itself through this?
It sustained my enthusiasm. Started long before I knew Lulu. It started with my first sight of the score of the lyric suite before the piece was ever recorded, and that was in 1937.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember it very vividly because I was very confused, depressed about where to go as a composer and about the state of contemporary music, etc.
Yeah.
And I opened that score, and everything changed instantaneously for me.
So that was the great moment in your career.
Right.
And
it determined, I found my sources and my direction then.
How fantastic.
And, of course, this was a time when nobody was interested in that music. I won't say nobody. I mean,
yes.
Milton Babbitt was interested. A few other people, you know. They came to this music around the same time.
Now,
but the music at this time wasn't being played anywhere, you know. And it was treated as though it was something of the past.
Mm-hmm.
There had been this fad or something, you know, of this interest in Schoenberg and all this activity. And there had been an opera called Wozzeck, which had been played in this country too and widely in Europe. But that was all over now.
And nobody really knew the music of Schoenberg in the early 30s at all.
No.
He hadn't.
Not only here, but nowhere else.
Yeah.
You know, those few people who were interested were on the sidelines.
George, you're actually here not to discuss yourself as a writer, but as a composer, you know, and on the 14th of this month, December, at Merkin Hall, the Abraham Goodman House, there's a premiere of a work of yours, and it's called Serenade 3. And we're going to talk about that in a second, but I want you to tell us what you have programmed of your music for this show.
Well, today's program consists of the Ballade for Piano, which was written for Richard Good, who is the pianist that will be playing the first performance of the Serenade 3. And then the second piece is the Toccata for piano, played by Robert Miller.
Mm-hmm.
And then finally, the Concertina for Piano, Winds and Timpani, which is played by the fellows at the
Berkshire Music Center.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Well, this is a beautiful program, and it has exclusively piano music in it.
Right. I brought a lot more piano music with me, but you tell me there won't be time for it today.
Well, there's other programs, George, and we will do another one. Yeah. In fact, you have just spurred my taste in an article by David Burge on your six etudes, which are recorded for New World Records, and which, before I knew you, I thought were great celebrations of piano music. This man here has written an amazing article on them in Keyboard Magazine. So I know you're pleased with this.
Right, yes, I was.
Well, let's get to the ballade, which will be the first piece in the program, and it's going to be played by Richard Good, who is the artist who will premiere at Merkin the Serenade 3. Now, the first question that comes to mind with the title ballade, Chopin ballade?
Was
that an... Tell me about it.
Right. I had in mind to write a sizable piece without any preconception as to form, and with a form that was more, let's say, of a narrative nature, rather than the kind of thing that you have in a sonata form with recapitulation, development section, and so on, and where you're conscious, you know, of a certain kind of thing that you want to, to do. Now, these recapitulative forms are rather natural in music, you know. The Chopin ballades are free. Now, in a certain sense, you know, if a piece is organized, it's just as strict as a sonata form.
Right.
But I wanted to let that take care of itself somehow.
Mm-hmm.
And I listened to the Chopin ballades a lot before I I wrote this. And also in all my piano music. I love writing for the piano. And when I wrote my etudes, I was very much involved with the whole tradition of etudes, you know, listen to them.
From Cramer to George Perle.
Well, I didn't bother so much about Cramer, but the great etudes, you know, of Chopin and Liszt, who was absolutely... I love the piano. I think I could have been a very good pianist. Because, you know, I never practiced, but I could always do certain things, like play trills and all sorts of things, you know. I had a certain natural facility. But composition obsessed me since the time I was six, from the very beginning.
Really? That
and,
early?
And I should have, you know, I guess I miss not being a good pianist because I know I could have been one.
Well, George.
So everything I feel about the piano, I put into piano music, which I can't play, but I know how it works.
Uh-huh.
Very comfortable about the piano, and I think people who play my piano music feel the same way about it.
And you know when it's a good performance, also.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, let me just say this: you would have needed three more lifetimes to have played the piano if you took 20 years for one.
Yes,
book
I suppose.
On one opera.
Yes.
Now, does this is this a work that had a long gestation period, as many of yours do?
It took a long time to write,
mm-hmm.
Yes. Although it's not such a long piece, 9.5 minutes, I think I worked on it for about 9 months, the normal gestation period.
Well, we're going to hear the ballade. What year, George? Around.
2 years ago, I think.
Uh-huh. So this is a recent work of yours.
Yes, it's just been published by Peters.
Oh, wonderful.
Not recorded yet, but I hope it will be fairly soon.
Well, we have a tape performance by wonderful pianist Richard Good, and we now hear George Perle's Ballade for Piano. Thank you. You have just heard The Ballade by George Perle in the hands of Richard Good. What a magnificent composition. George Perle is my guest, and the 14th of this month, Richard Good, who just played that, will be playing the world premiere of Perle's Serenade 3. What does that mean, Serenade 3, George?
Well, I have all three serenades are for 11 instruments, and each one has 5 movements. I took the title from the way in which the word serenade was used in the 18th century, mm-hmm. Which it's something between chamber music and symphonic music. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't have the tight, pre-established structure of the symphony, 5 movements rather than 4. The piece was commissioned by Frank Taplin, who commissioned myself and a number of other composers for chamber music with piano. Mm-hmm. And I asked him if I could do a piece for 11 instruments, which is a rather big thing. And he said, okay. So it's a piece that I'd had in mind for many, many years. That is, nothing had happened, but it was back there. Mm-hmm. I hadn't written a note of it.
Working its way up.
But I knew very well that I wanted to write a third serenade. The first serenade has a viola solo. Mm-hmm. The second serenade doesn't have a solo part, but the instrumentation is similar in each one. Each one has a saxophone as well as the standard four woodwind instruments, and percussion plays an important role in each of the three.
Well,
the third movement of this, by the way, is a memorial piece for George Balanchine.
Of the Serenade 3.
Of the Serenade, and that happened in a more or less accidental way. I had gotten started on the third movement, and I got stuck at one point. It wasn't going at all. Then one morning, I always work about 4:30 in the morning or so, or sometimes even earlier, and I work for a long time before breakfast, but that's my composing time. If it doesn't go then of course it doesn't go any at all during the day. And I was stuck for about, a week or something. I had something that I thought was pretty good, and then I tried some more, and I kept throwing it away. And I got up this morning and started to do something, and I kept going and kept going. And then I had forgotten that my wife and I were going to the service, the Requiem service at the Greek Orthodox Church for George Balanchine at 8 o'clock that morning. Mm. And I realized, suddenly the thought occurred to me that that's what I was doing. And I realized that I was writing something that was a kind of chorale and that would fit in with this sentiment, that I was feeling about this, although it was unconscious, it wasn't intended mm-hmm. in that way. I hadn't even connected the two.
How fascinating.
But the piece did get started somehow. So I maybe there was a connection between my mood, and the piece. I don't know. But I felt that I ought to have his name up there in view of the fact that that it gave me the key for the movement. And
the secret keys that open a door to a composer's work are so varied. It's a labyrinth. And yet it's so interesting to hear you speak of it, because when you start thinking, you can make these connections.
Yes.
Music is not just composed out of notes.
Well, of course, what you think of, you think of the notes. You think of whether you want the oboe to play a tune or flute or, what the harmonies are going to be. But obviously there's something else that makes the whole thing work.
It's so interesting, George, that...
how, I don't know.
Yeah, how. It's wonderful, and yet so many areas of it you do know how.
Yes.
Because you're a great constructor of music. And you're also a teacher of music, and I should mention that since 1961, you've been on the faculty of the City University of New York, Queens College. So you do this after you compose. You get up at 4:30 in the morning, and then you teach also.
Yes.
And then write books. And yes. You wonder why you can't play the Liszt Sonata or your own Ballade. And that brings me up to your own Toccata. And that was dedicated to a pianist who died recently.
Yes.
Extraordinary champion of contemporary music.
Yes.
His name, Robert Miller.
He was responsible for this piece and many other pieces. He played a number of works of mine. He played the etudes and he played the concertina, which the program today concludes with, and he probably would have, I'm sure he would have played the ballade, except that it was written after his.
Did he get to play the etudes?
But he did play the etudes, yes. And this piece was written especially for him. Yes.
I don't know if you even know this yet, but in this article by Burge, he says, George Perle's six etudes in these remarkable pieces, Perle demonstrates that there are still new things to explore at the piano, even without plucking or strumming inside the instrument or concocting new kinds of notational barriers.
Yes.
Well, it's nice to be understood, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
You wanted me.
But I think the piano is an infinitely interesting instrument.
Yes.
I mean, what you can do with your 10 fingers, you know, on the keyboard is always...
Well, one can practice some of those passages right in your own ballade to all eternity, you know, for all time. You wanted me to read your own liner notes to the 1969 Toccata.
Yes,
let me
do it. You had asked me to say something about it, and I suggested that you read this instead.
We're going to hear it, and I'm going to say that this is your own description. Ever since my first article on 12-tone music was published, more than 30 years ago, it has been...
Now it's more than 40 years ago.
Now it's more than 40 years ago. This is a 10-year-old recording. It has been obvious to almost every critic who has been called upon to comment on my work that I must be a composer of 12-tone or serial music. 40 years ago, that made me avant-garde, and today, that makes me academic. But the fact is that in all these years, I've written only three pieces in which one can discover tone rows or serial procedures. And of these, I've discarded one, and the other two have never been published or publicly performed. And yet you are tabbed that 12-tonalist, right?
Yes.
Now I'll read the Toccata itself. The Toccata, like almost everything I've written, but rather more decisively than many of the pieces that precede it, I think, reflects my preoccupation through all these years with something one might provisionally call post-diatonic tonality. If I tried to say anything more about this concept in this brief note, it would be misunderstood. Besides, I hesitate to tell listeners in advance what they ought to hear in a new work of mine beyond what is already implied in the title itself. The piece was originally called Toccata in D, but I thought this might imply too much, and perhaps some things that I don't want to imply. When a colleague told me that he considered this title inflammatory, I decided that I would simply call the piece Toccata. Well, that's a mouthful there. And George Perle's Toccata is now going to be played. Do you want to say anything before?
No.
Okay. Robert Miller.
Just what I said there, the title should be enough. Everybody knows what a toccata is, and
exactly.
My piece is a toccata.
And it's no longer indeed.
Which means that it also, it ends with as decisive a focal point on D. It converges on D just as much as any tonal piece of the past, but the D does not arrive by means of the traditional triadic relationships.
Yes.
But there are other relationships that make it possible to do this kind of thing, and that's what I mean by this is the subject of my second book, 12-tone tonality.
Exactly.
But this is something, an idea that I've been working on since 1939.
We're going to hear now George Perle's Toccata, Robert Miller, the pianist. Thank you. You have just heard the Toccata, composed by my guest George Perle in 1969 and dedicated to Robert Miller. And it's 6 minutes in length, and it's extraordinary work. It's published by Presser. And after these messages, indeed, George, you're right, I should give a plug to CRI, who has done so much for contemporary music. And this record has other composers' works on it, Warren and Volpe, Weiner, and your own Toccata, CRI SD306. It's an extraordinary recording and should be in the collection of everyone that cares for contemporary piano music. Let's have a break, and we will be right back after these messages with more discussion by George Perle. We now return today's subject, the music of George Perle, the composer himself sitting opposite me. And on December 14th, there will be a world premiere of his Serenade 3 at Merkin Hall, the Abraham Goodman House. Please get tickets to this. It's at 8 o'clock, I presume, George, but I know you well enough to know you're not sure. So call
right,
up.
But I suppose it's 8.
I'm sure it is. You know, the next work we're going to hear is your concertino for piano, winds, and timpani. Tell me about the creation of this piece.
Well, that was commissioned by Paul Fromm, and it had its first performance in Chicago by Ralph Shapey and his group at the University of Chicago, and the pianist there was my colleague from Queens College, Maury Ritt, mm-hmm. who was also the person who premiered the etudes.
Aha. Uh-huh.
And this particular performance was given at Tanglewood in 1981, I guess, yeah. Mm-hmm. I was composer in residence at Tanglewood that year, and it's being performed here by the fellows, the Berkshire Music Center fellows, conducted by Gunther Schuller. The soloist is Julie Lustman, and it's 9 minutes, but I wanted to also say what a wonderful it's a wonderful performance. These young people are not quite professionals. That is, they're ready to be professionals, but they don't have the experience yet.
Mm-hmm.
And so we can rehearse them all we want.
So you got what you wanted.
Yes, and it was a very exciting. It's very exciting to see these people. Well, to work. It was educational for the composer as well as for them.
How interesting.
To see how they assimilate these complicated new rhythms and how Gunther works with the wind players, you know, to get them to hear the harmonies. It's an absolutely marvelous experience.
Is this a published work?
Well, for me, yes, it is.
Who does
the
it?
The publisher is Walter Bolke Beaumart.
Let's hear, George, your concertino for piano, winds, and timpani. Gunther Schuller conducting, Berkshire Music Center fellows, soloist Julie Lustman in your work composed recently. These are all recent works of yours. This is the concertino for piano, winds, and timpani. Thank you. splendid work, a work of greatness. The concertino for piano, winds, and timpani. Soloist Julie Lustman, Gunther Schuller conducting, Berkshire Music Center Fellows. The composer, my guest today, George Perle. After these messages, we will be back with another work by Mr. Perle. George, your music has not only momentum and great structure, but it has emotional power. And I didn't know that many of your works, and this I could hear three straight times easily. That's how much it rivets the listener. Mm-hmm. I want to ask you something. We have had three different pianists playing, and I know you're married to Shirley Rhodes, who is not only a sensitive human being, but a wonderful pianist. Does she play your music at all?
Yes. I have a tape here of a performance of my pantomime interlude and fugue, which really, in a sense, exists thanks to her. It's a piece I wrote in 1937, and it had its first performance 2 years ago. the reason for this long delay is that I sort of forgot about it. That is, 1937 is the same year that I got so involved with Berg and Schoenberg and all of these things, and my life and thinking as a composer changed, you know. Mm-hmm. So somehow this didn't seem so important to me, and I was going on to bigger and better things. Mm-hmm. And I sort of forgot about it. She dug it up, and
she looked at it.
She looked at it, and she said, "This is a nice piece. Why don't you play it?" And I looked at it, and I thought that she was right. I think it is a nice piece.
Well, this
is very different from my other music, but in many ways, it's still the same composer, in a way.
Yeah, that's an interesting thought right there. It's you, and you're not quite the same anymore in any way, but you could hear you.
I can identify the piece, and I like the piece. I think it's well put together.
And Shirley likes it.
And Shirley gave the first performance 40 years after.
Sounds like Charles Ives, you know.
45 years after it was written.
Well, it's you're a patient man, though. I mean, anyone that can write music slowly as you do, every note counts in your scores. There is absolutely nothing that is extraneous. Mm-hmm.
I think composers tend to be involved with what they're currently working at. And mm-hmm. if you go through a revolutionary change in your musical thinking, you're liable to discount things that you did before that. Mm-hmm. Then, of course, 40 years later, looking back at it, I see that it isn't bad.
Well, I'm wondering if perhaps
I shouldn't have thrown away a lot of music that I did throw away.
This piece I saved,
so I must have thought something of it.
Somewhere lurking in the brain said, this is a piece to remain. And Shirley Rhodes rediscovered it, and she played it in 1982. We will now hear the pantomime interlude and fugue by you, George Perle.
Yes, thank you. Thank you.
Composed in 1937, rediscovered by Shirley Rhodes, who just played that perfect performance of Pantomime, Interlude, and Fugue by my guest today, George Perle. George, you've had an extraordinary career. You are finally done with your Lulu book, which will come out sometime in 1984, the University of California Press. I know that your activities as professor of music at City University of New York at Queens College always keeps you busy. You're having a new performance in days, December 14th at Merkin Hall of the Serenade 3, and I thank you for being here.
Thank you.
This is David Dubal. Thank you for listening.
For the Love of Music, with today's host, David Dubal, WNCN Music Director. We hope you'll be with us when once again we meet to listen and exchange ideas, all for the love of music. For the Love of Music is produced by WNCN New York, GAF Broadcasting Company.
Thank you.